Okay, I apologize for that. Welcome everybody. So Schumann and the Law. Okay, and today we're going to be talking again about Schumann and his career as a law student and what we can learn from that. So the Schumann most people know is of course this giant in romantic music, embodying the 19th century quote from Professor Greenberg, the 19th century romantic tendency to combine literature and music and to use music as a highly personal form of self-expression, end quote. And again, romanticism in music is characterized by intense individualism, emotional expression, and a willingness to go beyond more established conventional musical forms. Okay, let me just begin with a musical excerpt, which I think really encapsulates and represents the musical power of Robert Schumann. And gets us really into the mood to discuss Schumann. This is an excerpt from his piano concerto in A minor, as you can see from the slide, Opus 54. And this piece was written in 1845, and we'll use this piece to sort of highlight the very romantic nature of Robert Schumann's music. So I'll play you an excerpt, and this will just sort of get us in the mood to understand Schumann as a person and a composer. I'll play an excerpt from the first movement just to give you a sort of preview of it. Right from the beginning, you can tell this is going to be very exciting and very expressive. He begins with a big jolt from the orchestra, and the jolt is very sudden, and it's a little bit unnerving almost, because it's not located in the piece is in A minor, and it doesn't begin on an A note. So it's sort of boom, out of nowhere, and then the piano comes in. You'll hear the solo piano, ba-bum, 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 in a very dramatic way. And then it leads into this sort of, from this sort of very almost kind of bomb-like, explosive introduction, it goes into a very more subdued, melancholy tune from the orchestra. Okay, so you heard the sort of explosive, right? And then that sort of more subdued, melancholy tune. It's a very short excerpt, but it's really, I think, a great way to start today's lecture. And it symbolizes sort of Schumann's talent in expression, in musical expression. Okay. So that's one aspect of Schumann that many people know. The second aspect is, of course, Schumann is very famous for many people because of his marriage with Clara Schumann. And you can see on the slide, the second bullet point, this is probably, they were probably one of the most famous couples in Western music history. And to use a modern English term, they were sort of a power couple. And their romantic relationship and marriage together has been written about countless times by various scholars, and something else that attracts a lot of attention. Right? His marriage with Clara Wieck, Wieck is her maiden name, right? Obviously, after they married, she was known as Clara Schumann. Clara Schumann, who was a very famous pianist and concert pianist and composer in her own right. And after Robert and Clara got married, they sort of formed a team. They traveled around Europe giving concerts. Often she would be the soloist and he would be the conductor. And their marriage also has gotten a lot of attention because it was a marriage which for long periods was very happy, but also was a marriage characterized also by sometimes tumult and difficulties. So that's gotten a lot of attention. And finally, as you can see on the last bullet point, the other aspect of Schumann's life that has gotten a lot of attention is, of course, his death and his tragic illness leading up to his death. Most scholars today believe that Schumann, through much of his life, suffered from mental disorder, perhaps depression, which ran in his family. His sister, for example, died, killed herself, it is said, because she suffered from depression. One scholar argues that if we were diagnosing Schumann today, he would be diagnosed as having, as you can see from the slide, bipolar manic depressive affective disorder. Most scholars also believe that Schumann contracted syphilis, the disease syphilis, when he was younger, which unfortunately developed into tertiary syphilis when he was older, which affected his brain. On the slide, you can see on the bottom right, I have the photo of a brain. Now, this is not Schumann's brain, but this is a brain showing the effects of syphilis, late-term syphilis on the brain and the injuries caused to the brain. And this caused Schumann to have worsening mental symptoms in the 1850s. He suffered from delusions. For example, delusions included hearing voices in his head, hearing music in his head, hearing the note A in his head constantly. He complained about this. Just so everybody can understand sort of what he might have gone through, here is the note A. So imagine hearing that. Schumann complained he would hear A in his ear all day and all night long and couldn't concentrate. He had delusions that people were trying to poison him, a very, very difficult situation for him and his family, culminating, unfortunately, in his attempted suicide in 1854, where he tried to kill himself by jumping into the Rhine River and in Dusseldorf, in the German town of Dusseldorf. On the slide, I have a painting of the Rhine River and Dusseldorf there. So imagine him jumping in. He was rescued, but then committed in an asylum. And one of the sad things about Schumann's life is he wanted to go to an asylum. He committed himself because he was afraid that his mental illness would cause him to hurt his wife and children. And in the end, Schumann died in 1856. We are told shortly before he died, his arms and legs were convulsing in the deathbed, and a very, very sad end to a life. And this is another area that many people have focused on. We don't have time to listen to this excerpt today, but I just put it on the slide. For any of you who are interested in listening to a piece that Schumann wrote in the 1850s, when he was really suffering from all of these symptoms, you should listen to his violin concerto in D minor, which I have on the slide here. It's a very haunting piece. I think it's a very beautiful piece, but it's also very haunting. And many music scholars have argued that this piece, given certain uneven areas, they say, especially transition areas in the piece, it manifests sort of Schumann's descent into increasing madness. Okay. Of course, that's a controversial interpretation of the events and analysis of the violin concerto, but this is just for your information. Today, we're not going to focus on any of these aspects. We're not going to focus on the marriage to Clara, and we're not going to focus on the end of his life. We're going to focus on his early life. And because this is a law lecture, we're going to focus more on his life as a law student. But I did want to begin by just putting this all into context. Now, Schumann was born in the bucolic and small German town in Saxony called Zwickau. I apologize to any German speakers in the room. I'm probably am butchering the pronunciation. But he was born in this town in 1810. It was a small town, a very pleasant town, described by his father as, quote, one of the loveliest and most romantic regions, so filled with natural beauty that it could truly be called a park. And on the slide here, I have various pictures for you. On the upper left is a map of modern Germany. Of course, this is Germany during the time of Schumann did not look like this. Germany was consisted of a confederation of states. But here is just a modern map of Germany today. You can see where Zwickau is located, the arrow pointing to it. On the right, to its right, you have a painting of Zwickau from the 19th century. And then you see on the far right, a painting of Schumann's home. And then at the bottom, you see the home of Schumann preserved today. It's a museum. And then you see here in the middle, a statue of Schumann located near his house. And then here, a photo of the river that runs through the city of Zwickau. So this is Schumann's birthplace. His father was a man named August Schumann, who worked as a book dealer and a publisher of the local town newspaper. He was a self-made businessman, which is very interesting and impressive. He built his fortune through hard work. He ran a publishing company. He was also a lover of literature and a writer. He enjoyed writing medieval romances, for example, and he was also quite cosmopolitan in his literary tastes. We know, for example, that he published German language translations of British literature, notably Sir Walter Scott's adventure novels, and also the German translations of the Spanish author Cervantes. And we know that he published those translations as well. Indeed, one of his contemporaries at the time described Schumann's father this way, quote, "I never saw him do anything but work," unquote. A very hardworking individual. And from what we know from his son, Schumann, who we are talking about today, August Schumann was, by all accounts, a loving father and a loving husband. And he loved his children very much and introduced them to literature and his love of literature. Schumann would later say, later in his life, Schumann would later say that he loved his father very much and that he missed his father a lot. Schumann's mother, Johanna Christiane Schumann, was a music lover and enjoyed singing and encouraged Schumann's musical talent, starting him on piano lessons at age 7. We know that Schumann also started composing around age 8. And Schumann himself was the youngest out of 5 children. And from the accounts we have, Schumann is described as his parents' favorite. So out of the 5 children, Schumann was the youngest, and apparently he was his parents' favorite and got the most attention, which I guess is not that strange, right? Many families today dote on the youngest in the family. Right? Now, Schumann's childhood and early life, we know that he was a very talented pianist. And one of the interesting things about Schumann is at a very early age, when he was a child, he had a great talent for improvisation, improvising at the piano, basically sitting at the piano and being able to improvise, come up with music, compose short little pieces, or, you know, if you give him a tune, a piece of music, he'll play the tune, but then he was very good at improvising, changing it a little bit, modifying it a little bit, and that was one of his main talents. Okay, let me just share with you a musical excerpt from a piece written by Schumann called Carnival. This was written in 1835. Now, you can tell from the date, 1835 is not his childhood, so you might be wondering, why am I sharing this piece with you? Many scholars believe, though, that this piece, which Schumann wrote in 1835 when he was 25 years old, this piece, which is a collection of 21 small pieces for solo piano, and the reason it's called Carnival is Schumann intended it to express sort of the festive nature of a carnival. Many scholars believe that the small piano pieces in this tune reflect sort of the improvisations that he would have done when he was a young child. So even though this piece was written when he was 25, I'm playing it for you now because it might, you can hear it and imagine the young Schumann improvising these kind of pieces. Okay, so I'll play you 2 movements from it. The first movement, Eusebius. This is interesting because Eusebius was sort of a name that Schumann called himself. Schumann basically, later in his life, he came up with 2 names for himself, nicknames, you could say, Eusebius and Floriston. Eusebius was the name he used to describe his sort of neishang, introverted, calm self. Floristan was the name he used to describe his waishang, extroverted, almost impulsive, excited self. Right. So we'll begin with Eusebius. So you can see very pleasant, very calm tune, sort of representing the introverted Schumann. Imagine him as a child improvising pieces similar to this. And then we get to Floriston, which I just described as sort of the extroverted, almost kind of wild Schumann. So you can see very different pieces in style. But imagine him as a young boy, as a young child, improvising similar type pieces. Okay. Now, besides a love for music, Schumann also had a great love for literature, and especially poetry. He believed that poetry was one of the highest art forms in really the world of the humanities and in the world of culture. We know that at the age of 15, he actually founded a literature club with his classmates, where they would get together and discuss German literature, drama. They would read difficult passages together and talk about them for fun. They met approximately 30 times. They also shared poetry that they wrote, and they shared this with each other. And Schumann is quoted as saying later, right, in his life, that, quote, "is not the entire life of the poet, a happy, pure, and spiritual one devoted to what is most noble and most high," unquote. I have this on the slide. Okay. I think because for Schumann, poetry was so important. It's sort of like, for those of you that study Chinese literature in Tang Cao, in the Tang Dynasty, right, poetry, shi, was considered one of the greatest cultural forms, right? There was a belief that poetry could express the individual, right? The expression sort of shi yan zhi in Chinese. Poetry can express really the zhi, the will, the desires, the outlook of somebody. And Schumann, you can think of as somebody like that, also who believed in the power of poetry. So as a teenager, he wrote poems. He also wrote song lyrics. He wrote essays. He kept a diary. He kept a notebook that he called, and I have this on the slide, quote, "Leaves and Little Flowers from the Golden Meadow, collected and assembled by Robert Schumann." He would carry this notebook around, writing poems, writing stuff about composers he liked, anecdotes when he went out for walks, things he saw, opinions of concerts that his mother had taken to and that he had attended. So he loved writing. And it is from this age that he also cultivated a passion for the art form called Lied, or plural Lieder in German, songs or art songs in German, usually for solo, voice, and piano, with lyrics taken from existing poems or self-written by the composer. And Schumann once described himself as, quote, "the poet and composer in one person." So really, he saw music as, just like poetry, as a form of really intense self-expression. Now, how did he get onto the path of the law? His father died in 1826 of a heart attack, and we know that this was a very traumatic event for Schumann. His father left behind a will dated June 1826, and we know what the will contained. The will said very clearly that Schumann was to get, you can see from the slide here, 10,323 Reichstaler in trust. Reichstaler is the form of currency, from which Schumann would get a 200 Reichstaler stipend each year, plus his father's piano, plus an additional 100 Reichstalers to cover the cost of university examinations. But he would only get this stuff if he agreed to go to university to study. Now, this is a big sum of money, big sum of money. And his father did not specify the major, right, what he wanted Schumann to major in university. But eventually, Schumann's mother, one of his guardians, Johann Rudel, who was a merchant and friend of the family, who helped take care of Schumann after his father died, and Schumann's other family members, they decided, what should you go study? Go study law, because law is a stable subject. It's a stable profession. It's a prestigious profession in Germany. And you can also move up the social ladder, right? Music, it's great. You can do it as a hobby, but not as a profession. So once this was decided for Robert Schumann, he graduated from what we would call secondary school today, the Zwickau Lyceum, also sometimes called the Zwickau Gymnasium, the equivalent of secondary school. He graduated in March 1828. Already Schumann, even at the age of 18, at his high school, you want to call it high school graduation, he was extremely talented. We know that just a few months before his high school graduation, he actually gave a recital where he performed an excerpt, public speaking, of an excerpt from the German author Goethe's Faust. And he also performed an arrangement of Friedrich Kalkbrenner, a composer at the times, piano concerto in D minor. Let me just play you part of the concerto, Kalkbrenner, and you can imagine Schumann at 18 playing an arrangement of this, okay? I'll just skip to the end. So imagine the young Schumann performing an arrangement of this shortly before his high school graduation, his excellent piano skills. Okay. At his graduation, in a few days after his graduation, he began his journey as a law student. And we have a letter that he wrote to his good friend, Emil Fleischig. I have a portrait of his friend, Emil, on the right of the slide here. And Schumann wrote this just a few days after his high school graduation. You can read it on the slide as well. Quote, school days are over. The world lies before me. I could hardly keep back my tears as I come out of school for the last time, though I was really more glad than sorry. He's referring to his high school, right? The time has come for me to show my mettle, right? My will. Here I am without guide, teacher, or father. His father passed away, remember, a few years ago, flung helplessly into the darkness of life's unknown. And yet the world has never seemed fairer than at this moment, as I cheerfully face its storm. So this is the 18-year-old Schumann, right? He's kind of concerned about the future, but he says he's willing to go forward and really show himself, right? And have this courage to go forward. And for those of you who are law students in the audience, you know, studying law requires a lot of courage, right? Because it's not an easy subject. So he began his life next as a law student. And overall, he was not happy as a law student, as you guys probably can imagine. So let's go through his life as a law student now, which will really be the focus of today's lecture. So Schumann enrolled in the University of Leipzig. We know that he enrolled on March 29th, 1828, to begin his career as a law student. On the right, I have a couple of paintings from the period around the 19th century of Leipzig. Leipzig was a very major town. It was a major cultural and musical and educational center. At that time, 10 times the population of Schumann's hometown, Zwickau. So this would be sort of like the young boy going, the young, not boy anymore, he's 18, the young adult going from the small town to the big city, right? Sort of like going from the small town to Shenzhen or to Shanghai, right? And full of excitement, right? One of the important things also, besides being an educational center, Leipzig was a musical center as well. And this would, of course, be very good for the young Schumann because he could continue his musical interests. So for example, as I put on the slide, Leipzig at the time contained various top musical publishers, not just in Germany, but in Europe, including the publisher Breitkopf and Hartel. And on the bottom of the slide, you guys can see, this is, you can see the book, edition Breitkopf Schumann, Marschenbilder, one of his works for violin and piano. Breitkopf and Hartel are still in operation today, and they still publish music. And you can see the book, this music, sheet music at the slide that they still publish even today. Now, just some historical context involving German legal education in the 19th century, so we can understand what sort of Schumann was doing as a law student. German universities in much of the 19th century were considered the most prestigious and widely emulated in the 19th century. They were respected by Britain, America, and other countries. And as one of my former teachers used to say, he used to always say that if you were doing a ranking of universities, everybody knows today, what is everybody obsessed with universities? Rankings, 排名, 大学排名, right? Universities, who's number one, 2, 3, 4, 5. And today, what are the top universities in the world? They're always what? You know, Harvard, Yale, Oxford, Cambridge, Peking University, Tsinghua. But if we were in the 19th century, the top universities, there would have been no American universities and probably very few British universities. It would have been German universities, right? So Schumann was entering into this really revered educational world of German universities. Here's a fun quote for you guys. John Austin, for those of you that study law and legal theory, you may know John Austin. He's the famous English legal theorist and English legal positivist, right? He wrote this about German law and German legal education. He traveled to Germany in the 19th century to visit some German universities and to study German law, which he hoped he could bring back to England. And he said this about German law and German legal education. He said, quote, "German law greatly and palpably superior, considered as a whole, to the law of England. Turning from the study of English to the study of German, Roman law, you escape from the empire of chaos and darkness to a world that seems by comparison the region of order and light." So for Austin, English common law, English legal education, darkness and chaos. German law and German legal education, order and light. We also know that German law schools generally in the 19th century had a desire to produce gentlemen lawyers, lawyers with very good humanistic and legal scientific training. Students were well-trained in German law and especially Roman law being seen as really the precursor of continental legal systems, and canon law, which German legal universities, canon law, the law of the Catholic Church, which also had a great impact on the development of Western law. Okay, German law schools were also, just as music was, influenced by the idea of romanticism, right? And so German legal education to some degree also emphasized individuality, the notion that students should recognize their potential and develop their talents, the importance that romanticism placed on the history and the past. This was also taken up by German law schools. So they emphasized legal history, studying Roman law, for example, gaining a systematic knowledge of law. And German law schools also engaged in what scholars today call a scientific approach, sort of empirical investigation, verification, induction, right? Specialization. And the idea that if you proceed down a very specific type and rigorous analysis of the law, anyone, you, me, Schumann, can discover the secrets of the law. And one of the interesting things also in German legal education in the 19th century was that universities, law faculties employed a variety of teaching methods. Yes, they had lectures, but they also had seminars where students would discuss papers with professors. Professors would often assign practical assignments similar to what we would call legal hypos, right? You get a hypo, hypothetical, and you have to come up with a legal solution and discuss it with the professor, and research papers as well. So this is the kind of legal education world that Schumann was entering into. Was Schumann a good student? Well, for those of you that were here when I did the Tchaikovsky lecture, you will remember that Tchaikovsky actually was a pretty good student. He was ranked, when he studied law, I think it was in the top 10% of his class. And he took his study seriously. Well, Tchaikovsky graduated, you guys remember. He graduated from his law studies from the Institute of Jurisprudence in St. Petersburg and became a legal official. Schumann, was he a good student? It depends who you ask. Schumann, in his letters to his mother, presented himself as an excellent student. However, from his roommates and friends, probably not that great. Okay, so Schumann, he himself said later in his life, you can see from the slide, when he was later in his life, when he looked back, he wrote this about himself. He said, quote, "At 18, I went to Leipzig in accordance with my mother's wishes to study law, but actually it's more in accordance with my own still vaguely formed intent to devote myself entirely to music," end quote. Now, after he arrived in Leipzig, he wrote a letter to his mother, May 21st, 1828. And you guys will notice I have a lot of letters from Schumann because I really want you to, I want us to experience what Schumann was thinking, or at least the perception that he wanted us to have. So that's why I have all these letters on the slides. He wrote this letter to his mother in May 21st, shortly after he arrived in Leipzig. Let's take a look at it together. Quote, "I arrived here last Thursday quite well, though a little depressed, and took my position as a student. After a few days here, I still feel quite well, though not quite happy. My whole heart cries out for the quieter home where I was born. In other words, he's homesick, 想家了, right? Which is perfectly understandable. How many of you guys, when you started university at 18, you 想家, you became homesick, right? 思乡, right? You're thinking of your hometown, right? And then he describes law, right? Chilly, cold jurisprudence. Another translation by another scholar uses the word ice cold law, right? This translation uses chilly jurisprudence, right? With its ice cold definitions would crush the life out of me from the start. Medicine I will not, theology I cannot study. Thus I struggle endlessly with myself and look in vain for someone to tell me what to do. And yet there is no help for it. I must choose law. However cut and dried it may be, I will conquer, and where there's a will, there's a way, end quote. This is not a letter by somebody who's excited to study law, right? Ice cold definitions, chilly law, right? And then next month, he wrote a letter to his mother again. He seems to say he's a good student. Can you guys see on the slide, quote, I go regularly to lectures. I practice piano 2 hours a day. I read for a few hours, study. I go for a walk. In the law lectures, I take notes mechanically, which is all I can do for the present. However, his friend, do you guys remember his childhood friend, Emil Fleischig, said, actually, Schumann never set foot in the lecture room. And Schumann later in his life, when he looked back at the time at his law student years, he joked with people. He would say, yeah, I went to lecture. I went to lecture. You know what I did? I would go to the door and listen a bit by the door, eavesdrop, and then leave. I went to lecture. Okay. Was he a good student? Probably not that great. We also know that he drank as a student. He described himself in diary entries in 1829 as very drunk. He had hangovers. He also said, if I had been drunk or have vomited, then on the next day, my imagination soars and is enhanced. Okay, so he drank. This is not unique, right? Many university students drink, right? I'm not saying that that's great, but it's just a fact of life. Right. Okay. So he was just a sort of classic university student. And rather than attend classes, he continued composing and playing piano. And he studied piano. He found a local teacher named Frederick Wieck. Now, for those of you that have been paying very close attention, you should recognize this Xing, this surname, this last name, this Xing, Wieck. Because do you guys remember that was his wife's maiden name? So actually, Clara, who would become his wife, was the daughter of his piano teacher. Okay? And one of the interesting things we won't talk about today, but if you guys want to read more about Schumann, one of the interesting things is his later, when he tells his teacher, I've fallen in love with your daughter, right? He told his teacher. His teacher, Frederick, was shocked, and he actually did not permit them to get married. And there was this huge lawsuit. Because in Germany at the time, his daughter Clara had to get his permission to marry. He didn't give it. And there was a huge lawsuit, very interesting. And finally, the court ruled for Schumann and allowed them to get married. But this was a huge kind of drama. If any of you guys like watching Zhongguo Lian Shi Zhi drama series, don't watch that. Study the marriage between Robert and Clara. It's the best Lian Shi Zhi. It's the best drama you will experience. Now, he continued writing and composing, so let me just share with you some musical excerpts from his time in Leipzig. One of the things that he wrote in 1828 during his time as a law student in Leipzig is a song. You remember I had mentioned that Schumann was very interested in the art form, the Lied, or in plural, Lieder, German art songs, right? Songs for piano and voice. And one of the songs he wrote was this song, An Anna, to Anna, which is based on a poem that was written by Justinus Kerner. And you can read the lyrics there. This is basically a love poem, right? It's a poem expressing love, right, for a person, a woman who has basically died, okay? And Schumann set this to music. And remember, Schumann has a reputation for being this composer of German romanticism. So listen to the song and you can hear this is a really expressive song, expressing also Schumann's own emotions in his time at Leipzig. Okay. Okay. That's odd. The give me a second. The piece is not showing in my musical list, but let me find it. Here it is. Okay.
Nicht im Tale der süßen Heimat, beim Gemurmel der Silberquelle, bleich getragen aus dem Schlachtfeld, denk ich dein, denk ich dein. Süßes Leben, denk ich dein, du
so we'll stop there, but you can get a sense of the very dramatic nature of the song. There was that part in the song where you could hear the singer was leaping notes, right? D-D-D, D-D-D, right? Sort of really the kind of expressive nature. I'm not going to sing, because if I'm going to sing, all of you will leave the meeting, I'm sure, out of horror. So I won't actually sing it, but you will recall that DDD, DDD, right? So this sort of very expressive kind of nature. He also wrote a piano quartet in C minor in 1829 during his time as a law student at Leipzig. And he was very much influenced by the Austrian composer Franz Schubert. You have a, by the way, the paintings on this slide, the top painting is a painting of his teacher, Frederick Wieck, who would become his father-in-law. The bottom painting is of Franz Schubert, the Austrian composer. Schubert died in 1828, which was during the time when Schumann was at Leipzig studying. And from his roommate, we know that when Schubert died, his roommate said that Schumann cried in his room all night, right? But I'll give you, let's listen to an excerpt from the piano quartet, specifically the minuet movement. This movement, because Schumann himself, when Schumann was older, he looked back and he said, quote, "I remember very well a spot in one of my works about which I said to myself, this is romantic. Here is a spirit different from that of my earlier music opened up for me. A new poetic life appeared to reveal itself." So Schumann is describing a very important composition of his from before. And this spot, which he refers to in this quote, is this piece, the minuet from the piano quartet in C minor. So let's just listen to it. Okay, and I have it here. This next part, now this next part. So you guys hear the beginning of the minuet, the sort of fast scherzo movement, and then there's a transition to this very sort of very pleasant trio section, right? That's quite romantic, right? This is the section that Schumann is referring to. So even in 1829, the point is you listen to these pieces from when he was 19, already you can see the very expressive nature, right, of his music. Okay. Now, Schumann, he decided to leave Leipzig. He decided to transfer to another university to continue his law studies, the University of Heidelberg, okay? And he enrolled there in July of 1829. Now, he did this for a couple of reasons. One reason is so he could be closer to his good childhood friend, Gisbert Rosen. You can see Rosen is the painting in the middle. By the way, the painting at the top is Schumann around this age, around age 19, okay? And then you have Rosen. The other reason was that Heidelberg was considered a more prestigious law school than the University of Leipzig. And so his mother approved the transfer. She also believed that if Schumann goes to Heidelberg, he's going to have better employment chances when he becomes a lawyer, okay? And again, and then at the bottom of the slide, you guys can see there are some paintings of Heidelberg, okay? And of course, the University of Heidelberg still is one of the oldest universities in the world, right? Established in, I think, around 1368. I don't remember the exact date, but around 1368, its law school continues to be one of the most prestigious in the world. So Schumann was a student there. Now, after he moved to Heidelberg, he wrote to his mother again, and he claimed to dedicate himself to law. So one letter, as you guys can see, dated July 17, 1829, he writes, quote, "I now appreciated the true value of the law in that it promoted all venerable and noble interests of humanity." Another translation I put on the slide here, "I begin to realize its true value, the law's true value in furthering the highest interests of mankind." This is, of course, he wants to satisfy his mother, right? So he's trying to present himself as, wow, the law is great. But actually, I always loved this quote because I always thought, even though Schumann may not have been sincere, you know, maybe even though he may not actually have thought these things, right? It's still a wonderful quote. You could imagine, couldn't you imagine law schools using this as a koh-hal, as a slogan, right, to describe law? Law promotes all venerable and noble interests of humanity. However, I think most law schools will not use this quote because people ask, who said this quote? And then law schools say, Schumann did, but Schumann dropped out. He's not exactly somebody you want as a spokesperson for your law school, right? But anyway, he later describes to his mother even his schedule. He claims, "I wake up at 4 a.m. I study law until 8, that's 4 hours, right? I play piano till 10, and then I have classes from 10 to noon, and then I have lunch, then I have more classes from 2 to 4. We know that he took classes, or he presumably took classes. We don't know if he actually went to lectures, but Roman law, natural law, church law, constitutional law, and international law. In reality, rather than focus on his law studies, we know Schumann continued his writing. He tried writing some novels. He continued his piano. He continued composing. He also partied. He drank. He spent money. Okay. I don't think, to be fair, I don't think we should, again, I don't think we should be objective. We should not criticize Schumann for this, right? He's living the life of a university student, at least like a typical, American or university student, right? 大学生生活, right? You know, you enjoy yourself, right? So he did. He partied, he drank. This is a letter, because of time, I can't read the whole thing out loud, but it's a funny letter just to show you his life in law school. He wrote this letter to his mother in February 1830. Basically, it's asking for more money. 他没钱了, right? He wants more money from his mother. 生活费 for his living expenses. And you guys can see what he spends his money on. Let's just read the first part. "Now comes a sore point, my finances, which are in a bad way, and I also have debts. I wish I could show you those documents, my tailor's bill, my shoemaker. The tailor has 90 florins, and I still owe him 55. My coat was 85. My pants, 86. I had my blue coat and my black coat, repaired." And then he talks about his shoemaker he needs to pay. He also says, "I need to drink. I need to eat. I need to smoke. Okay, and I need money for alcohol." Okay. Interestingly, he tells his mother, "I need money for drinking, but I need to have that money. I have to have money. Because I have to, as a student, I have to go to events and they serve drinks there and I have to drink myself." Okay. Okay. Now the key document, which reflects his leaving law to go to music, is finally he makes this decision. He makes it in a letter he writes to his mother in July 30th, 1830. And he described himself, Schumann described himself, that these were the most important letters that he ever wrote and he would ever write. Okay. And in these letters, basically, he tells his mother, I really don't like law. I want to pursue music. Okay. Let me just, sorry, I think. Yeah, this slide got skipped. I apologize for that. My computer froze and this slide got slipped. Before we get to that, we know that in law school in Heidelberg, he was impressed with two law professors there. Just very quickly, so you guys have the background. One law professor named Professor Joseph Mittermeier. Joseph Mittermeier was a criminal law scholar. He's very famous even today because he's considered as one of the most vocal scholars at the time who wanted to reform criminal law. And he was not a supporter of the death penalty. And he spoke out against capital punishment. So very progressive type ideas. Another professor who Schumann actually got very close with was a professor named Anton Friedrich Justice Thibault. Again, I'm sorry, I'm butchering the pronunciation probably. Thibault was a civil law scholar who was an expert in civil law. But Schumann got close with him because Thibault was a music lover. He wrote a book called Purity in Music, which was basically a book where Thibault argued that the best music is music of the past, music, for example, from the 17th century, and that modern music was not good. And Schumann would go to his house. He would go to Thibault's house. Thibault would host concerts in his house, and Schumann would talk to his mother about these concerts. So in a letter dated February 24th, 1830, as you guys can see, Schumann describes his time in Thibault's homes. He basically says Thibault, every Thursday, he would have 70 singers come to his house and sing pieces written by the composer, well, English/German composer Handel, and that Thibault would play the piano, and that when Thibault played the piano, he would cry because he loved the music so much. And Schumann was very moved by this. And in fact, Schumann's friend would later say that Professor Thibault was really the first substantial and persistent influence on Schumann's inner life. Now, a couple of points here. First, it's interesting that Thibault and Schumann liked Handel. Handel's a great composer. Some of you may know him for his famous oratorio Messiah, right? There's the famous piece from there, the movement, Hallelujah, 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 right? But Handel, interestingly, did you guys know, he's also somebody who started studying law at the University of Halle and then left law school to pursue music. So there's a sort of connection between Handel and Schumann there. But according to Schumann, Professor Thibault recognized also that Schumann had a love for music. And according to Schumann, his professor Thibault did not encourage him to be a lawyer. In fact, Thibault may have even encouraged him to, maybe you should leave law school and pursue your true passions, okay? Now, again, Schumann makes this decision to leave the law for music, and he writes this in a series of letters to his mother in July 30th, 1830. If you guys don't mind, let's read part of the letter together because I think it really shows Schumann's thinking. So I know there's a lot of text on the PowerPoint, but if you'll bear with me. So he actually wrote two letters, one at 4 a.m. and one at 5 a.m. So picture him, he's writing these, right? He's thinking all these things. So 4 a.m., except for the touch of frost, rhyme frost, with which jurisprudence sometimes chills my early morning. Do you guys remember he also described jurisprudence as ice cold when he started studying as Leipzig? Do you remember that? So he's still thinking of law as cold. My days would be all sunshine, fresh and radiant as dew flowers. My failure to rise above the average of legal study will be no fault of mine, but of circumstances, perhaps also of my own heart, to which Latin has always been quite alien. Real efficiency is unattainable without native inclination. So what is he saying there? He's basically saying, I don't think I can rise above average in law. I always will be below average in law. And the reason is because he says of my own heart. And he also says, I'm not very good at Latin and law requires Latin, right? And he says, no, real efficiency is not attainable without native inclination, meaning I can never be really good at law because I don't have the will for it. I don't have the natural will for it. And he says, no automatic machine-made lawyer can excel in his profession. So he's basically telling his mother, if I become a lawyer, what am I going to be? I'm just going to be a machine, a heartless machine who hates my job. And then in another letter, he writes this. 1 hour later, he writes this letter. My life has been for 20 years, one law struggle between what? Music and law. He actually says music and law. My aims were as high in practical life as in art, but what prospects are there for an ordinary person, plebeian, who does not have any real love for legal details, pedagoguing legal details? Now I stand at the crossroads, trembling before the question, whether law or art, music. My own instinct points to art, and I believe it to be the right road, but it always seemed to be that you rather barred my way in that direction. So he's being very honest with his mother, right? He said, I love music, I'm gonna do it as a career, but you persuaded me not to do it, right? You didn't want me to do it. I quite see your excellent motherly reasons, known to both of us as a precarious future and an uncertain livelihood. Meaning, I understand as a mother, as a parent, you were afraid that if I do music, I'm not gonna have a future. I'm not gonna be able to support myself. But a man can know no greater torment than to look forward to an unhappy, empty, and lifeless future of his own planning. But neither is it easy for him to choose the profession directly opposed to that for which he was destined for his youth. He's basically saying, I can't choose a profession, law, that I know since when I was a child that it's just not suitable for me because I love music. A month later, he's even clearer in his determination. He writes to his mother a month later. But whether I put the question to my head, heart or reason, view it in the light of past, present, or future, or according to my abilities, hopes, or prospects, everything from my childhood onwards points to an artistic career. Okay. Think of my father, who early on understood me and intended me for art or music. So he claims that his father supported him, would have supported him. And you guys remember in his father's will, do you guys remember his father didn't specify the zhanye, the major, right, that Schumann was to do, right? His mother and his family chose law for him. And he told his mother, look deeply both within yourself and myself and ask yourself whether I could endure the deadly monotony of the practice of law for my entire life. And this is one of my favorite lines in the letter. Schumann asks his mother, can you picture me sitting in an office from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m.? Okay. And then he in this other part of the letter, he, in a very literary way, he pretends he's talking to two people, art, Mr. Art and Mr. Music. Mr. Art and Mr. Law. And he says, Mr. Art says, I am free as air and the whole world is my haven. Mr. Law says, my practice involves constant subordination at every step of the way, an immaculate dress. Translation into simpler English, law is about what? Constant subordination, you know, making yourself low and just looking nice in good clothing. Mr. Art says, where I am, there is beauty. I rule the heart. I am unshackled and infinite. I compose and am immortal. What does Mr. Law says? I have nothing to offer you but musty deeds, documents, right? Village arguments, village squabbles, right? 一些就是根本一些鸡毛蒜皮的一些冲突, right? It's just some ridiculous, trivial conflicts between people, or with sometimes with exceptional luck, the exciting mystery of a sudden death, right? Sometimes you may be really get an interesting case, right? All right, and Schumann even describes himself in 1829, 1830. He does a description of himself in the third person where he basically says, I am more emotional than intellectual, right? I am more subjective than objective, right? Meaning he's really set on music. Now his mother initially opposed this, and also his brother, Carl, opposed this. His brother, Carl, was actually very upset. And for a long period of time, his brother, Carl, said, if you come visit me, don't bring any musical instruments to my house. And you can't put any musical instruments in my house. And I think we have to understand why his mother and his his siblings were not very supportive. You guys remember I mentioned to you, we think that Schumann was the favorite, his parents' favorite. He was very spoiled as the youngest child. He had the most opportunities. He went to university. He studied law. So his siblings basically were like, 你被宠坏了. You're just a spoiled brat, right? You're studying law. Now you want to go study music? But eventually, under certain conditions, his mother did support his decision, and she wrote to him, quote, "So now you are left to handle the situation entirely on your own. May God give you his blessing. That is my prayer for you." And so she gives him his blessing, and Schumann embarks on the life. He leaves law school in September 1830. He becomes a music critic, a writer, a composer. He marries his piano teacher's daughter, Clara, which I said caused a lot of problems, right? But eventually, just so you guys know, in the Institute in drama, there's always a happy ending. There is a happy ending. He and his father-in-law, they reconcile. They become friends again, okay? He also becomes a music director and conductor in Dusseldorf, Schumann does. However, his worsening mental condition is there, and it leads to his attempted suicide, institutionalization, and eventually death. Now, to conclude today's lecture, we've looked at Schumann's life as a law student, his decision to leave the law. We also talked about Tchaikovsky. For those of you who attended the first lecture, again, you don't have to have attended it because I'll go over Tchaikovsky a bit again here. What can we learn? Or what might you be able to learn as a law student from their lives as you're thinking about your life? Well, first of all, we have to acknowledge the differences between Schumann and Tchaikovsky. Remember, Schumann dropped out of law school to pursue his love for music and music as a career. Tchaikovsky didn't. You remember, Tchaikovsky completed his legal studies at the Institute for Jurisprudence, did very well, top 10% of his class, and he worked as a legal official in the government for a couple of years, and he worked hard at that. And we know that Tchaikovsky actually got very good evaluations from his bosses. After he worked for a few years, then Tchaikovsky decided, I'm leaving being a law official. I'm going to do music, right? So two different approaches. Both of them left the law for music, but one left a lot earlier, and one left later. And you know, maybe some students think, is law really my passion? What should I do? Well, here there are two approaches, right? Schumann, he leaves, doesn't finish law school. Tchaikovsky does maybe the safer approach, what we might call safer approach. He graduates from his law studies. He tries the legal profession. He makes sure he does well, right? In case maybe he music doesn't work out, you can come back to law, okay? But eventually they both follow their passion. So there is a difference between their approaches. Now, they do have some similarities which we should keep in mind between the two of them and their life. I think their life shows us the importance of support from friends and family. Tchaikovsky, in his decision to pursue music, he had a lot of support from his family, especially his sibling and sister, Sasha. If you guys attended these Tchaikovsky lecture, you will remember I shared with you a letter that Tchaikovsky had written to his sister Sasha, where he was sharing his decision to leave law for music. And he told Sasha, I'm doing this, thank you for your support, I'm gonna work really hard. Right? So he had that support there from his friends and family. Schumann had support from his mother. Remember, ultimately his mother did give him her blessing. Teachers. Tchaikovsky had support from his teachers, of course, his music teachers, but remember, even in law, in his legal study, Tchaikovsky's law study included a lot of musical activities, and the school had a chorus and extracurricular activities. Had music extracurricular activities for him to pursue his music. And do you guys remember Schumann had a professor, Professor Thibault, who apparently did not support Schumann continuing with law. In other words, Thibault basically said, maybe you should do music instead. And I think it's sometimes quite important, I think for professors, I think it's important for us, if we have a student who just started law school, who it's clear they hate this, they hate law study. It's clear that they were forced to do this and that they're very, very unhappy. Maybe, I'm not saying this works for everybody, but maybe it is the responsible thing to do as professors to advise us to, you know, if you really hate this, maybe it may be better to find what you're really interested in earlier rather than later, rather than suffer through 3 years of law school. I mean, just to give you guys a personal anecdote, I have a friend of mine who is now working in movies. He does movie production, but he did law school first in America. He studied law, but then during his first year, he realized, what am I doing? So he left and he found a job working in Hollywood as a movie in a movie production company, which he loves very much. And he always told me that he's glad he left early, because he left early, which means he saved time, he saved money, rather than, you know, forcing himself to leave, you know, in his second or even third year. Yeah, I'm not, again, 别误会, don't misunderstand me. I'm not saying people who don't like law should just leave law school, right? I'm just saying that these are things to think about. Both composers show us also, again, the importance of luck and timing. Tchaikovsky, for his, he was very lucky to have support. He was also very lucky that when he wanted to study music, as I mentioned in the Tchaikovsky lecture, there was a music school available for him, the St. Petersburg Conservatory, which had just been established. For Schumann, there was also a lot of luck in his life too. The support from his mother who came, being in Leipzig and Heidelberg, cities with a lot of music opportunities, where he was able to meet performers, soloists, composers who traveled to these cities. If he didn't go to university in these places, if he went to basically like a 文化沙漠, a cultural desert, maybe he would not have had this luck and timing to actually solidify that, oh, I want to do music. I also want to just point out, and this may be very common sense, but the importance of staying healthy. You know, both composers, they found their true love. They left law to do music. But if you guys notice, they both died, in modern point, of course, relatively young. Both of them died in their 40s and 50s, right? So I know this may be a common sense point, but obviously if you find your passion in life and you're pursuing it, definitely stay healthy. Never forget your health, because the longer you live, the longer you can do what you love. At the same time, we should acknowledge the limitations of applying their lives to ours, okay? And I mentioned this in the Tchaikovsky lecture. Obviously, both composers definitely had natural talent, which, of course, not everyone has natural talent to pursue their true passions. And obviously, one thing we should always remember is both Tchaikovsky and Schumann were not poor. Schumann's father left him a lot of money. Tchaikovsky came from a noble family. They had the money and resources to discover and pursue their passions in music. Not all of us are that lucky, right? Not all of us may have the monetary resources to do this. I would just conclude with one more statement. Is the other limitation to think about it is, remember Schumann, do you guys remember in one of the letters to his mother, he struggled. He said, I've reached a fork, a crossroad, law or music. But one thing I hope you guys think about, especially for law students today, is in 2022, in today's year, we don't necessarily have to think about things in law or music. One choice A or choice B, you can only choose one. No, the world is different and you might be able to do both. You could imagine a career as a lawyer, but then pursue your other passions, right? There are plenty of examples of successful lawyers who have law jobs, but then they pursue jobs as musicians, artists, writers, literature people in their spare time. The trick, of course, is finding a career that will allow you to do this. So for example, if you guys work at a 律师事务所, a private law firm, a big law firm, it might be difficult to find the time to do both law and your other hobby. But maybe another type of career, like if you work in the government, government hours are usually more predictable. If some of you become law professors, being a professor is a wonderful way to pursue your interests in law and maybe philosophy, law in literature, law in art, right? And that may be a career also to think about. So the final point I want to leave you guys with is, for these composers, Schumann and Tchaikovsky, one limitation about applying their lives to ours today is for them, they had a choice A or B. They had to choose one or the other, it seems. For us today, it may not be that necessary. You might be able to find a job where you can both do law and your love, okay? To give you guys an example, I have a friend of mine who's a practicing lawyer. He's also a musician. He practices music law. He represents composers who have been sued or are suing others, basically for plagiarizing their music works. And as part of his job, he has to analyze the songs, the music, compare them. He says, this is a great career for me because I have the stability of being a lawyer, but also I can keep up my music skills. And I apologize again, we don't have much time for questions. I went over time in speaking, but I think we have about 5 minutes for questions. So maybe we have time to take one or two questions if anybody has any. Let me answer the question in the chat from DP. Is it because they finally realized that they couldn't find the utopia or the idealism in the law? On the other hand, music provide the comfort and a path to their childish, or I guess childhood might be a better way to put it, innocent dreams. Now that's a good question. I think for Schumann, for him, at least the way he put it, I think he always knew since he was a child that music was something that he was passionate about, music and literature. And you can tell that when he studied law, it wasn't something even when he started in Leipzig, he describes law as ice cold. This was not something that he wanted to do, right? His mother and his family made him choose law, okay? So I don't think it's that he went to law school and he genuinely was trying to find idealism and he just couldn't find. I think for Schumann, it was more just, he never was interested in it. He would never have been able to find the idealism. Right. And music was there. Tchaikovsky is more interesting. Definitely as a child, I think Tchaikovsky always had a passion for music. But again, the difference was Tchaikovsky did study very hard in law school. He did very well. He applied himself. So it's possible for Tchaikovsky, he may have tried to find fulfillment as a law student and as a legal official. And then in the end, he was unable to realize DP in your question, the idealism. He found law was quite boring. And so then he decided into music. So that's the difference. Your question may reflect the difference between those two individuals. And I think we have time maybe for one more question if anybody has. Professor Friedman.
Thank you, Professor Hall. Very interesting. In your research, did you have any indication that there was actually a benefit for Schumann, that he studied law, maybe in his contacts with the publishers or with the symphony halls?
To answer your question, not so much with his publishing or symphony hall work. But I can't answer your question this way. There is evidence to suggest that his legal training, albeit short, did provide a benefit to him in his legal lawsuits against his father-in-law. You will remember that his future father-in-law, his father-in-law did not support the marriage at first. We know that Schumann hired a lawyer and they ended up suing each other. He sued for the court to give permission to marry. And we have evidence that actually his father-in-law lost control during the lawsuit and in court was accusing Schumann of being basically a lowlife, a drunk. And from the reports that we have at the time, Schumann was very calm. He composed himself very calm in court. And that may have been from his legal training. We also know that actually after he won that lawsuit and he got permission to marry, Schumann actually sued his father-in-law for slander, for all of the things that he had said about Schumann in the earlier trial. And I think you can, he hired a lawyer, I think, to do it, and he won that lawsuit. So I think that is evidence of how his legal training may have been useful. So it does go to, I think your question is also important because it also goes to the point that even if one pursues one's passion, the legal training can come in handy. So that may be an argument if somebody is considering, should I continue law school or not? Maybe continue it, equipping you with this toolbox of skills. So I would like to thank everybody for their participation. We're out of time, but this will be recorded. The recording and PowerPoint will be made available on STL social media. And I'd like to thank everybody for coming. And I wish you a good day. Okay. Just a very quick note. One of the participants says he sent his father-in-law in prison. Well, the sentence of the court was actually that his father-in-law had to spend, I think, 8 days or so in prison, 8 days. But there's no evidence he actually ever served that. So he probably didn't go to prison. Okay. All right. Goodbye, everybody.
Thank you.